Good afternoon, and you're welcome along to Local Media This Week, the programme where we talk about what's in the papers and sometimes online, but all matters concerning County Clare, and we generally look at Clare Echo, the Clare Champion, and online with the Clare Herald. Now, a little bit like, you know, was it Paul without John and Yoko without the Beatles? I'm afraid the band is sort of split up this week, and there's not too much of it left. So the sub is in sort of trying to keep control of the two stalwarts that are here. So I have Pat O'Brien and David Fleming. So it's a threesome this evening where we'll be trying to sort of police you along and see how things go. So, gentlemen, a very good afternoon
to you. Good afternoon to you, Luke.
Good afternoon, Luke.
Right. Now, listen, we spoke last week in relation to the Clare 250 and the Cancer Centre. And David, I think you alluded to the fact that there was obviously a little bit more to this than meets the eye. And Dan Danaher has on page one and page two in the Champion, I suppose you'd say, a follow-up article. And it's regulator called in to Cancer Centre.
Yeah, and I suppose that was inevitable. We were thinking that might happen last week, and sure enough, the regulator has been asked to address a number of complaints. The Champion understands that five people, two of whom are themselves cancer patients, have written to the charity regulator expressing transparency and governance concerns about the Clare 250 Cancer Centre CLG. So the regulator is a state body, a legislative body, statutory body to regulate all charities. And it was set up in the wake of, people might remember, the controversies around Rehab and Goal and a few other high-profile charities. And they have a lot of power. They have the power to close you down, and the power, I think, possibly even to fine, but certainly to sort things out. So the company, Dan Danaher relates there what the company says they're supposed to be doing.
Yeah, there's a bit more meat on page two, David.
There is a bit more meat, yeah, there is. And the last week, the Champion revealed the total from proceeds of the annual Clare 250 cycle from 1995 to 27 was 4.2 million. And the proceeds from this cycle were used to fund annual trips to Lourdes for cancer patients and to fund the development of Clare 250 Cancer Care Centre. And it goes on and talks about what other costs and sums were spent on. And how they were trying to count. There's an awful lot of figures in there, which we won't bore the readers with. I mean, a lot of that article is to do with figures. But that, unfortunately, is what the regulator is trying to investigate now, how the charity was regulated, and is it doing what it's set up to do? Because one of the accusations made, or one of the allegations made by some of the complainants, was that it's not, that the centre is not open every day. And that was denied by the Cancer Centre, in the 250 Cancer Centre. So we don't know actually what's what. And I suppose once the charity regulator does its report, then we'll know.
Yeah, like we said, the tail end of the article there, Dan, has there's a question in relation to why a Rowan cancer patient, Lorraine White, has been blocked from Clare 250 Cancer Centre social media platforms. The Board of Trustees replied, Miss White has continually stated that the centre has, quote, never been open to close for COVID, which is completely false. And then apparently there's a social media post in relation to it. And, like, it's there for everyone to read, but, you know, as we alluded to last week, this is just sad.
Mm.
Okay, because as I said, David, the cycle was probably before your time in East Clare, but all of us here in East Clare.
Money raised.
Yeah, but for such a great cause. Yeah. And I have no doubt that great work has been done.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there are issues.
Yeah.
You know, and.
There's another article there, Luke, on page four. Letters provoke anger and concern in cancer patients. Three Clare cancer patients were recently included in a Clare in the Clare Champion. Clare champion thought that with a statement made about the Clare 250 Kensington has received an anonymous letter containing a prayer card. All the letters are addressed with the person's name, care of the Clare 250 Cancer Centre, Ballygliffy, everyone in County Clare. There was nothing included in the letters that would suggest the sender is connected with the Clare 250 Cancer Centre. They include a card with the following prayer: O Holy Spirit, please help and guide me. Say this prayer 3 times+ per day. Lorraine White, who is a breast cancer survivor, expressed her surprise with receiving this letter and wondered why the sender hadn't provided their own name and address. So there's a lot of stuff.
That's getting dirty,
There's a photograph there of Lorraine with these letters, which are addressed to her at the cancer centre. So. They were sent to the centre, which she has made a complaint about. It's all, as you say, Luke, very sad when all of that sort of thing, because they were obviously doing good work, and they probably still are doing good work, but sometimes a long charity like that can divert, and that initial energy might lessen over the years.
Yeah, maybe. And I said even that the fundraiser there in the cycle race, the cycle race was 2 days. You know, they done all East Clare one day, and then they overnight in the Casey.
Yeah.
And then they do West Clare. And
that's right. So the line of the 250 was 250 miles. It was a big trek around the country.
In the last couple of years, it has maybe faded down to one day.
Yeah.
A 1 day race, you know, or one day cycle.
Yeah. It is disappointing, but listen, I'm sure there'll be more to come in the future. Now we're going to move on and. The main headline on the Clare Echo this week is an article by Padraig McMahon, and Pat, I'm going to let you discuss this one now. It's at rampant STI levels spark public appeal. Record levels of chlamydia are likely to be recorded in the Midwest region by the end of 2023.
Yeah, Padraig has it here on the leading article in the Clare Echo. Officials with Public Health HSE Midwest recorded unprecedented levels of chlamydia and gonorrhea this year. Members of the public and Clare are being urged to protect their sexual health and to avail of testing due to unprecedented levels of chlamydia
and gonorrhea this year. Is it because we have a matchmaking festival and it was so successful this year? Is that one of the reasons it's gone up?
Well, it might contribute to it, and I suppose we'll be talking about the French equivalent later on.
But could it also be a sort of a legacy of COVID that everybody was so stuck inside and they got a burst of energy?
Is it a bit like Valentine's Day has gone year round, maybe, or something like that?
But of course, it is. We're jesting here, but of course, it's a very serious thing. In 2022, it says here, Public Health HSE Midwest, which I suppose is this region, recorded the highest number of both chlamydia cases, 798. Now that is high, and gonorrhea 188. So not as high as that. In the past 10 years. It's in the past 10 years. So year to date in 23, there have been 606. Year to date in 2023, there have been, wait for it, 664 cases of chlamydia. So in 10 years, we had 798 cases. And just this year alone, we seem to have 664 of chlamydia and 274 cases of gonorrhea.
Probably so eight months of the year.
And that's only 8 months of the year. So no wonder they're kind of worried about it.
Yeah. Now, I will have to sort of give the copy people on the Echo a bit of a slap, because it says the full story is on page 12 and 13, but it's not. It's actually on page 17.
Oh, controversial.
So in the article there, it's record levels of STI in the Midwest. And I suppose it just goes through the stats and bits and pieces like that. So,
yeah.
Now, I know there are initiatives that have been taking place, you know, we'll say, especially this time of year now at colleges and stuff like that. Yeah. And, you know, there's free contraception, I think, being...
There is in the universities.
Rolled out.
But it says here, Luke, that people can avail of free home testing via www.sh24.ie. SH24 testing has accounted for nearly 40% of all positive chlamydia cases in the Midwest so far this year. So obviously people are using that service.
Yeah.
And of course, it is a sensitive thing for certain people, and they mightn't want to go to their local GP, but for whatever reason. But so this is another option now for them. www.sh24.ie, and you presumably receive the test in the post, and you send it back. So that's one way of trying to assist the situation.
And I suppose we're just going to turn the page to page 19 in the Echo there. And Mental Health Week is coming up. World Mental Health Day is Tuesday, October 10th. And there's a load of different talks and stuff like that that are going on, I suppose. You know, bearing in mind the way that things are gone now, if somebody is having trouble with sort of, you know, a few of those conditions that we've alluded to, maybe, you know, their mental health might be affected. Mm. So, and in a totally unrelated issue to what we were talking about there, on page 18, David, Diocese launches Vocations Initiative.
Well, it is. Yes, they seem to be. And you'll notice in the Clare Champion, there is a big, it's quite a sizable ad for this effort being made by the Diocese of Killaloe. It's on page 11 of the Champion. And so this is, it appears to me, Luke and Pat, that the Catholic Church have leaped from the 19th century straight into the 21st century by taking this particular approach towards vocations. We all know that vocations have been declined drastically in the country since the 1980s, and it has been continually going down. So this is an effort, I think, by the diocese to encourage young men. Of course, the Catholic Church doesn't recruit women into the priesthood, so
I think they might.
Out.
I said we could have that debate could go on for years, David. I think now we could all agree that if there were more women involved, that they might get more men.
They might,
you know.
But so it says here anyway, with just over half of the 58 parishes in the diocese currently served by a resident priest. So half of 58. Is whatever it is, it's nearly 29.
Yeah.
So only 29 parishes have a resident priest. Vocations Director Father Iggy McCormack, who is pictured there in the Echo with seminarian Mark Nestor from Ennis, who's a seminarian in Maynooth. Father Iggy McCormack, who's at St. Flannan's, says there is hope the three vocations recorded in the diocese during the past 12 months can be built on during the year for vocations to the diocesan priesthood. Geographically, we are the third largest diocese in the country, has become increasingly difficult to maintain full cover across the five counties due to retirements and a lower number of vocations. So, I understand that they have hired a consultancy company to do this campaign for them.
Yeah, I was listening to another station this evening on the way over, and Father Iggy McCormack was on, who was the director of the vocations, and he said that they had hired a consultancy firm to promote this.
And that probably explains these ads, which are very slickly produced.
And there is an ad on the Echo as well there. Here I am, send me. Who will go for us is the hidden. And if anyone wants to contact them, visit www.killaloediocese.ie.
Yeah, and vocations at killaloediocese.ie. And you can also follow them on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter, or we should now call it X, I think, rather than Twitter. But that man there, David, Mark Nestor, he's an ex-politician.
A name familiar to me.
He's a man that resigned from the council, to take up his vocation. So in fairness, whatever way you think about it, he's to be admired for what he's doing. And I said, we'll wish him the best of luck. But so he's starting out on his career. But on page 5 of the Champion, there's a few priests that sort of are well beyond the end of their career, because there's a title, Graves Uncovered in Ennis Cathedral.
Well, this is a very interesting story. Andrew Hamilton has the story there on page 5 of the Champion. And yes, it appears that the diocese forgot about these priests, even though they were under their feet, literally, in the cathedral. And since, according to the article by Andrew Hamilton, contractors, Martin's Construction, were removing the floor, the lino floor, that was put down in about 1973.
Well, it's a floor that anyone that's been in a church will recognise from that picture.
The original floor now is what we're seeing there in that photograph by John Kelly. And they discovered these, it's a sort of a tile floor. And as you say, Luke, it's very typical of what you see in any church. But quite distinctly, there are four rectangular bits of it, which are very distinct. And there's a cross, and they do look like grave markers. Mm. And sure enough, they think that they are four of them there. They don't know who they are. There are some plaques on the wall. And so that might be a clue. There is a plaque for a Bishop Flannery of Killaloe, who died in 1901, and a Father Patrick Barry, who died at 43 years of age in 1900. James McInerney, who was a young priest, who died in 1895 and may have been native of Venice. So there, I'd say, they're the people who are buried underneath there.
Yeah. It's you could pass a comment about it's not the first time that the Catholic Church has forgot about people that they buried.
Maybe when they're finished digging in the Abbey Street Cart, that they'll move up there.
Pat, you know what? You took the words right out of my mouth, because that's the next thing we're going to talk about. Page one and page two in the Champion. And I was going to say things are getting a bit dirty, but sure, they've been dirty for a while. And it's a bit like now, David, you spoke about consultancy firms earlier for the Catholic Church, but the DAC, 2040 DAC, had to hire a PR firm with all the grief they were getting over the previous activity. But anyway, a war of words has heated up.
They have 10 million to spend, Luke. They have a 10 million fund.
Yeah, exactly. No, and I suppose we're... The article on page one, The Champions, by Sharon Dolan Darcy, who we're going to talk about just a little bit in the second half, but the war of words between Ennis 2040 DAC and Save Ennis Town has heated up in recent days, with Ennis 2040 DAC responding to claims made by the voluntary group about the Ennis Street car park, or the Abbey Street car park. So go on, Pat, take it away.
Claims is the start of an archaeology league at the car park last week ahead of a controversial plan to develop the area. The Save Ennis group has described the redevelopment as destructive to the town. The big thing, as is being referred to locally, are excavations undertaken by Archaeology and Built Heritage Limited under licence to investigate the ground at the site and obtain archaeology. I have to pronounce it properly, Luke.
Yeah, there's a lot of big words in the papers this week. We'll all be struggling a little bit.
Archaeological heritage and information. It is hoped the findings will shed light on the heritage of the site before any proposed development, and will inform the design process for the landmark building. Yeah, so I heard this fellow from the 2040 on the radio there during the week, and... he was answering all the questions that was put to him, and he said that when this dig is done, that it was going to decide on what kind of a design the building will take.
That seems very strange to me. Usually, you see, when an archaeological dig happens, you upset the archaeology. You even remove a bit of it, unless now it's very significant and they can leave it in place, but. Usually they kind of destroy the site, but to learn about it, you know, it's good destroying. But the War of the Abbey, War of the Words, Ennis 2040, I'm now gone to the Echo. It's page 10 of the Echo. And there's a nice picture there of the Save Ennis Town group at Harmony Bridge there, and the Abbey Street car park is there at the back. And you can kind of see the construction work or the archaeological work going ahead. But anyway, Ennis 2040 have come out of the traps. This is the company now.
David, this is the PR firm hired by Ennis 2040 DAC have come out of the traps.
They have, and they have said that false claims made in the papers last week And they've said that the company is not a private company. It's 100% owned by own subsidiary of Clare County Council. It is a not-for-profit, and the members of the board consist of public, private and local elected representatives, which give their time voluntarily. Reference to the what was called ill-conceived and expensive development in the market by Save Ennis Town was also criticised by Ennis 2040 DAC, who noted it was an entirely separate development and bears no relation to any of the Ennis 2040 projects.
I think they're talking about history there, Pat. Basically, that it mightn't have been called Ennis 2040 DAC, but it was the council that were sort of responsible for making a balls of the market, and
yeah.
They sort of seem to think that they're going to make a balls of this
because,
as well.
People of Ennis said that the people of Ennis. Remember the Marcus Street, which cost 1.3 million, and there was another white elephant.
Yeah, and I don't think anyone can deny that that's literally what it is.
Now, the Save Ennis people committee were on the radio as well, and they said that the Clare County Council had 300,000 a year money out of the Abbey Street Care Park.
In parking fees?
In parking fees,
that's
yeah.
a significant amount of money, Pat.
It is a huge amount of money.
It is a significant amount of money. What I'm uncertain about is when they build this building, will it be leased to people or will they sell it?
Oh, no, it's going to be leased out.
It is public property after all. So presumably you'd be thinking they should be getting more than 300,000, would they? They would hardly get that, would they?
Well, they have a commercial development in the bottom and office space in the top.
Yeah.
I don't know.
If you were going into the bottom of that as the head of a company, they'll go into the bottom and you go in and this building is there, and the first thing you'd be asking, you know, where the customer's going to park.
Yeah. Nationally at the minute, the vacancy rate on property is, I think, in the region of 16%. That's nationally. Mm. And you'd imagine that
it's a bit higher than us, I think.
I would imagine that it is, you know. So just sort of potentially say that if this was built in the morning, you'd say that, well, straight away 20% of it isn't going to be open.
Now, you would presume, though, and of course, it does change very quickly, and. But you'd presume these are intelligent people on the board of this company, and they've got research and they've got data that tells them this is the best thing. I would hope now, and I would, if I was a member of the Save Ennis group or if I was a concerned citizen, I'd be asking them to show us the data on which they've made this decision.
Well, I think that's sort of part of the problem, that they're saying that, you know, they'll come out and tell everybody what it's all going to be. And they've alluded to, you know, in the articles there, that said, oh, well, when the big dig is done, they'll be able to give a better idea of it. I'm sorry, no, that doesn't wash. Mm, yeah. You know, to me, it looks like... I don't know if now maybe the council are all knowing and they sort of they have got the sort of stats and figures to back it up to say that it's going to work, but this whole thing in relation to just in relation to parking and all the rest of it, Ennis is never the easiest of places to get around because of its nature, right? And you sort of say that, you know, if they say that the future is that we're going to have buses and all this type of stuff, well, that's very well and good, but I said, Pat, if you're coming in from the Bridge or David, myself, are coming in from Tungraney, where are we physically going to hop on the bus to bring us into town? Where is the park and ride facilities?
And you see, it's all right for all that stuff, and they have all these buses around these Clare now and all around the county, and they have three of them passing my house, I think, going to Limerick every day. But you see, all this thing should have been done years ago where your bus is provided, because people are used to getting... I'm used to going out now and getting into my car and going to Innes or going to Limerick or going to Tullagh or going to Scariff. And I'm not going to be going around checking to know when the bus... If I didn't have a car, maybe I'd have to do it.
Yeah.
But the fact that people...
You'd be nearly entitled now to the free bus, would you?
I would, yeah.
Would that encourage you at all? I actually think... If all public transport was free to every citizen, it would create...
It probably would,
It might change a few attitudes. No, I'd be the same with you. Like, there are certain people who who won't because they're not used to it. Whereas if you do live in a town or a city, you're probably used to the bus, you know. But Ennis is, even with buses, Ennis would be clogged up very quickly.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. It would. Now, we'll move on from that. And we're going to go north-west to page 14 of Declared Champion and to a topic that's close to both your hearts, and that's the Liston Varna Matchmaking Festival. Andrew Hamilton has an article there in the North and West Clare page in the Champion, page 14, and says, "Mid all the hype surrounding the Rugby World Cup, the Liston Varna Matchmaking Festival will be making headlines in Paris this week at a special event organised by the Franco-Irish Ball Association." Now, Pat.
And that's not a rugby ball, I don't think, is it?
I don't think so. I think this is a...
Yeah, well, I think that that article we were discussing on the front of the Echo there a while ago might be very relevant around Paris, so it's all Irish people over there.
The end of the article basically says, "It's a Franco-Irish ball. We'll see two lucky participants chosen as Queen of the Bourne and Mr. Liston Varna, as was traditionally done at the last chance dance, which closes the festival on the last weekend of every September."
That's a brilliant name. Yeah. The last chance dance.
And then we hope we can entice Willie Daly and his daughter to come to Paris soon. "He believes that love is waiting for everyone. It's there just waiting to be found. When it is, it's a lovely feeling. Paris is a magical place and so is Liston Varna. The alchemy between the two places could be fantastic." Now, it's the first time I've heard Paris and Liston Varna sort of be linked together in the same sentence.
I think I know which one I'd prefer to go to. But there's obviously some sort of a ball or something happening over there. And there's a picture of, I presume it's a model named Liv Monahan.
No, she's a Cork musician. Multi-talented singer. Both, and she's also a costume designer.
Well, there you go. And she probably designed this particular outfit wearing the 2023 Paris Liston Varna dress, if you don't mind. So she's going to be there, I suppose. So what more can you say about that? Except, we're a bit away from St. Valentine's Day, though. So
yeah, when is this ball going to hit, Luke? There's a lot of rugby. There's a lot of rugby supporters
and
over there.
You don't want to be distracted.
I'd say that you meant to go to Liston Varna ball in Paris.
Okay, right. Now we go from balls.
We'll just cross there to Luke to the Shannon Town page there. Just
go on,
another French connection restored to Shannon.
Oh, yes.
An Aer Shannon Paris service commenced on last Friday. On the first flight were many Irish rugby fans travelling to Ireland versus South Africa match. Mary Constant, CEO of the Shannon Group, said, "After a busy peak summer season, it's fabulous to see passengers aboard the first flight to our new Aer Lingus service to Charles de Gaulle, in addition to wearing a gateway to the Rugby World Cup. We know this will be a popular destination for family, friends and couples alike, wanting to explore the history and culture and cuisine of Paris while providing a vital connection from Shannon to major European cities." So
I think this is brilliant because, Paris, the capital of France, and to have Shannon connected to the capital of France is a big deal. Yeah, I know it was there before. What would you, I don't know, did you follow the national story with Ryanair pulling, I think, 10 flights out of Dublin recently?
I haven't, David. We don't really care about Dublin, David.
That's to do with charges, I think.
It's additional charges. Now, it's no benefit to Shannon, because they're just simply moving they're just cancelling future flights. Now, Ryanair, of course, constantly revise their schedule, so they might be making a bit of hay out of this, but it is a bit of a spat between them and the Dublin Airport Authority.
Yeah.
And I think they're linking, I read it, I don't know if it's on this now, but I read it as well during the week, where they're linking the Paris Shannon flights to connect, maybe you could have a connection to, if people wanted to come from Paris and go to the States.
That makes sense.
But of course, when you think about it, they must be going to some place that you can't go to from Paris, because sure, Paris is one of the busiest airports in Europe. There is a new flight another recommenced flight, the Delta has come back to Shannon, and they are returning their New York JFK service, which which I think was popular. It means a bit of competition,
yep.
which can only be healthy.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So that's coming next year, I think. So we'll look forward to that.
It's coming in the spring. Yeah.
Right. There's
it's,
one.
It's in the paper there somewhere.
Yeah. Before we finish part one, I just want to pay just a little reference to. It's on page 4 of the Echo and page 2, 3 of the Champion. The Clare Stages rally took place in North Clare last weekend, and sadly, a competitor died during the rally. And we sort of pay our respects to Damien Fleming from Kerry, who passed away. But the side of what I'd sort of look at, and it's Andrew Hamilton basically is talking about it in the article in The Champion. You have these, we said the heading is Rally Trapped Locals in Their Homes Group Claims. Now, when you have events taking place, the chances are that sometimes you're going to have road closures and that, you know, people are going to be disaccommodated for a day. Mm. A little bit like, I'm not comparing like oranges with oranges now, but when the event is on down in Killaloe, you know, the cycling and the... that took place there there's not full road closures but there might be a few roll-in closures for a short period of time, but due to the nature of rallying, it's basically they have to sort of close the roads for the duration of the day, and there's issues in relation to you know, it's a sort of damage, sort of cost to the roads because of the nature of the roads that they're on. The Clare Stages rally is popular partly because of the reason the roads that they're on are nice and narrow, and you know, it's a competitive sort of route to do.
Yeah.
You know, and I was at the picture there, the damaged road surface just at Paula Whack there, close to Cairn. You can just imagine the cars doing handbrake turns going around it. But it sort of links to that. You know, I know there's insurance issues and you've closures and all the rest of it, but I sort of wonder, you know, are the council, do they get any recompense for damage caused to the roads?
Because it's a good question.
You know, because there's enough damage caused to our roads by the weather. The councillors will admit that they haven't enough money to be sort of repairing what they want to be repairing. But it's road safety in the north of Clare is a very prominent issue at the minute, especially in relation to, you know, a tragedy that took place there as well.
I would hope that there is some compensation given to the council if they are causing such damage.
And it's the second date on the Clare Stages rally. You had one here in Feakle and East Clare as well there a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
But
motorsport is a dangerous business, you know. I suppose it's just part of the what comes with it, and you know, a little bit like you spoke about earlier, you know, the Clare 250 cycle, you know, has rallying maybe on open roads. Right. I know they're closed for the stages, but on open general roads, is that maybe you're coming to an end, and maybe they'd start to put them all into forests.
A local living on that road, I'd be discommoded. I'd say I couldn't go out of my house. I'd say because of that road closure. Now maybe it's a very quiet spot, but I'm sure they headed in
the East Clare here, and they headed over all around our place. Yeah.
Does it last for a day?
Yeah, it's one day. Yeah, but years ago, Pat, you remember when the Tour of Ireland used to come up around here as a young lad went up, sort of sitting on the side of a ditch up in Feakle. Taking a look at it, you know. And you had roads closed for that as well. But
they used to have it a 2 day, but they have only one day now. The Clare Stages, really.
Yeah, it is. Anyway, listen. Before we go to, I was doing very well on time, and now I'm going way over. But there was one article that I wanted to get to, page 4 of the Echo. Blunder on Bunratty Bandstand sees the council pay 40,000 euros.
Now, that's a lovely alliteration. Blunder on Bunratty Bandstand. And it's Porrig has the story. It's a brilliant story, actually. How could it have happened? Clare County Council has been forced to pause works on the construction of a bandstand in Bunratty after realising it did not own the lands on which the structure was built. And it started back in June this year. They wanted to build this bandstand. There's a photograph there of the started works.
Foundations, yeah.
And they tried to establish, seemingly, who the owners were. It appears that the locals knew exactly who the owners were, and it's right behind the Creamery building, for those who are familiar with Bunratty, right behind the Creamery bar and restaurant. The council, to be fair to them, had been maintaining the area for the last, did they say, 30 years, yeah. So they thought they probably owned it. But I know exactly here what happened. They look up the land registry, and the land registry only records owners for
transfer.
If this had been owned by the same family for over 100 years, it wouldn't be in the land registry. They'd have to go to the registry of deeds. And so they probably didn't do that. But anyway, the local owner made himself known, or herself known, and they're well known in the area, according to Porrig. And according to this, the council in recent weeks are in negotiation, and they're at a very delicate point.
Yeah,
I can say delicate is a nice word there.
I'd say delicate basically would... I'd say it would be what the figure of euros is going to be.
That's how delicate it's going to be.
But that's not good now.
Councillor P.J. Ryan, independent, admitted that the setback was an unfortunate thing. The former mayor of Clare told Clare Echo he was optimistic that an agreement would be reached between the council and the landowner. I would be hoping there would be a solution found to it very soon, and the owners would see their civic duty to the area.
That's a bit of pressure.
I take grave issue with that now. Yeah. I said if the authority deemed to be capable of looking after our county
didn't know that they didn't own a piece of property.
I'm afraid that there's a bigger issue at heart there.
And to be calling on a person's civic duty to come up now and solve this problem. I mean, that's private property. And if it was my property, I'd be looking for a very large sum in compensation. And I'd be saying, you have to restore what was there and get out of it.
Now you could be talking about Mullagh Moore now, David, putting things back to where they were. Listen, right, we're done. Pat. Anybody alive or dead this week that we need to take care of?
Well, Creedence Clearwater Revival, Luke, did you ever hear of them?
I'm not that young, Pat. Of course I did, yeah.
Have we ever, and this is going to be very, as we'd say...
Appropriate?
Appropriate, as we're looking at it every day. Have you ever seen the rain?
Well, it disappeared for a week or two, but by God, it's come back in spades. Right, we'll be back in a few minutes.
You're welcome back. That was Here Comes the Rain. We're kind of sick of the rain, but anyway, Here Comes the Rain, Creedence Clearwater Revival. Pat, there's an awful lot in the papers, in both papers, about the Gardaí, and particularly in this area of the world, in East Clare. So it's page 9 of the Champion and page 12 and 13 of the Echo. And the main heading is... No Garda station closures on the cards, which must be a good thing. Dan Danaher has that story. And then at the bottom of the page in the Champion, same, Dan has, new model will not see movement of existing Gardaí in Killaloe and Scariff. It's effectively the same story. What do you make of that?
Yeah, and just Parag McMahon has them in the Echo as well. Resources won't be lost to Tipperary, Superintendent Ali Baker says.
Yeah, what's actually happening here now?
There's a part of Clare going in with Tipperary.
Yeah, it's a new Garda division as such.
It's going to be West Tipperary and East Clare.
Yeah, yeah. And the worries was that guards would be moved out. Yeah.
Well, it's going to be a big area because I think there you can show there where it goes back down to Borsakane and Tommy Vera and Clark Johnson, up around Dalla. and Moneygall and Portrush, and they're a long way from Kilnane and Fife.
Yeah.
So you have a big area to cover.
And there's a picture there of Superintendent Ollie Baker, who was meeting the local councillors in Killaloe, kind of to try to reassure them that there's nothing to see here. I suppose is the message that he was trying to give. He's to be based in various places, it appears, according to this interview and previous interviews. What about the story there, Pat, on page 12, contacting Gardaí now like dealing with air? What does that mean?
This is a quote from Ellen O'Callaghan. contacting Gardaí now like dealing with air.
Air don't have the best reputation, do they?
They don't, no. Ringing on Gardaí Síochána is like ringing air. With the lack of urgency to calls, an East Clare representative has claimed while Patrick Mahon. Speaking at Thursday's meeting, the Killaloe Municipal District Councillor Ellen O'Callaghan voiced worries for the future of on Gardaí Síochána. My concerns and concerns of a lot of people is policing. To look after the people the way policing has gone, it's more like a business and all based on stats, which I am very fearful for. I suppose he probably has a point, you know.
It's
difficult enough to get through one, you know.
We were, I think, talking to our own, the Scariff Bay, of course, has a regular Garda report every Saturday morning on Saturday Chronicle, and the advice from the Garda, Damien, was if in this part of the world, you don't phone Killaloe, you phone Ennis. Ennis,
yeah.
Ennis is open 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
So, need for policing to protect tourism reputation flagged. It's another one there. Attempts to increase the amount of Gardaí patrolling busy tourist spots in East Clare will be examined, writes Pádraig Mahon. An increased level of policing was sought by Councillor Tony O'Brien for the tourism amenities of East Clare. Speaking at the September meeting of the Killaloe Municipal District, he stated, "We have considerable resources gone into attracting tourism and amenities from Mount Shannon and Whitegate to Ballina and Killaloe, Drummaneer and Terryglass. I'd hope to see an increasing level of policing to prevent incidents we had in previous years. We had a serious incident in Killaloe this year, and I would like to commend on Garda Síochána and the agencies who responded. I want to see a level that would prevent those accidents, and when those type of people that come to cause destruction are dealt with firmly." I wonder what type of people he's talking about there. Is he talking about tourists or what? Tourism's importance to the region was acknowledged by Superintendent Ollie Baker. Tourism is huge in this part of the country. When the new bridge opens in Killaloe, it will open this part of the county. It is a more niche tourist market than West or North Clare, but it is still very valuable, he says. What do you make of that?
Yeah, I suppose you would have reached there with jet skis and things around the Killaloe.
Is that what do you think? Is that what they were talking about?
It's probably part of it anyway. Earlier.
But sure, isn't it very hard for the guards to stop that sort of activity? Because it's not illegal to have a jet ski, is it? Well, now I know that you could be breaking bylaws if you go too close to a particular area.
There's some bylaws I think there. That, yeah, and they've got to upgrade them. Whether they have.
But sure, come here to me, Pat. I'm on my jet ski. I've just broken a bylaw. How is a guard going to catch me on a jet ski? I don't know if there's a jet ski division in the Killaloe or a jet ski section. The special.
It's probably all a grey area.
Yeah. We saw, of course, recently the guards, the navy, the ranger wing, and the customs all operating together to get onto a ship in the ocean. So maybe we'll we hope we won't be seeing that level of activity in this area. But anyway,
encampments and speeding are the big issues. Joe Cooney says here at the Killaloe Municipal District.
Yeah,
I suppose
these are the illegal encampments.
He's referring to the encampment in Six Mile Bridge, and it appears that there's no binding law on that either. So
the law is the response that the guards can't rely on current legislation to deal with illegal encampments. So they're stuck between a legislative rock and a hard place on that matter. Anyway, there's an awful lot in the two papers about the Gardaí, but I think we'll probably move on.
Okay.
All right, we'll come back. Now, there's a few bad news issues. Sadly, for East Clare, last week we had the local news, we say very local to ourselves, David, in relation to Gala, Nylans Gala, that closed. And sadly, during the week, there was a fire in Walsh's Bar in Killaloe, and it's on page 11 of the Champion, and it's page 14 of the Echo. And the only good news out of this is that no one was seriously injured.
Yeah, and it happened, it was last Monday afternoon. Around lunchtime, Killaloe is very, that particular area, it's right beside the shop, isn't it? Or across the road from the shop.
It's literally just as you sort of start to go down the main street.
Go down the main street. Yeah. It's near the Garda station, isn't it?
Yeah.
And at 10 to 1, just lunchtime, this explosion happens. I know, by the way, I knew somebody who was there just 15 minutes before and walking just past it.
Yep.
And it all happened. Seemingly, they don't exactly know, I think, yet, but the Garda Forensic Unit combed the premises while locals, including former Irish rugby captain Keith Wood, waited to assist in boarding up the building. They don't know what actually happened. The presumption is, I think, gas, some sort of gas. And Pat, you were telling us earlier, before we went on air, that the gas in pubs is used for pumping the
beer
out of the kegs.
Yeah, but I think when I was reading the article here on the Clare Champion, it appears a fire started in the bar area.
Ah.
And in the heat, would explode the gas. The gas, yeah.
So people, Luke, were very lucky because the photographs look as if it was a pretty severe.
It was. And for anyone that was on social media, if they saw the fire that was there, it was. Now again, the good luck sort of side of it is it's literally about 200 yards away from the fire station. You know, so obviously the lads were there quick.
And I think Scariff and Nina were there.
And in fairness, the fire was extinguished fairly quick, and luckily no other adjoining premises were suffered much damage or anything like that. But listen, to the owners of them, we wish them the very best, and there's going to be a bit of a way back from that. I do know that it is a very popular, Walsh's was a very popular venue for live music and a lot of Ga talk. I'd say there would have been a bit of disappointing Ga talk for Smith O'Brien's at the weekend. But listen, we wish them the very best and hope they can get back up and running on their feet very quick.
Now, waiting for something like that to happen.
Absolutely. Now, listen, more bad news. And we're going to go to page 11 of the Echo. And the mayor of Clare isn't happy, Pat. We're sick of hearing a couple of weeks. If Joe's sick of hearing a couple of weeks, I guess he's not the only one, because we're sick of hearing about it as well. Mayor of Clare, Joe Cooney, received a round of applause from his colleagues when voicing frustration on the long-running wait for an announcement on Broadford and Coor Clare's inclusion in the pilot wastewater scheme, writes Pádraic McMahon. A frustrated Mayor Cooney said, "We're sick of hearing a couple of weeks at this stage. We have to move forward. Would you contact me by the end of this week with a date for this announcement? I'm sick of hearing a couple of weeks." That's basically in relation to Minister O'Brien, who had given the commitment in the schoolyard in Broadford. And as the man says, if there's a commitment given by a politician, page 11, Pat, if there's a commitment given by a politician, if he doesn't honour it it's going to come back and haunt him.
It's going to come back, yeah. Councillor Pat Burke there, Fine Gael, commented, "Shame on the government and shame on Minister O'Brien for making a promise to the people of Broadford and obviously not following up with the promise." Yeah. I mean, that's the point.
Yeah.
Deputy Crowe said, "There hasn't been a false dawn. Minister O'Brien didn't lead anyone down a garden path." God, he's using a lot of cliches there and mixed metaphors. But anyway, that accusation cannot be levelled at Minister O'Brien. He gave a commitment in the schoolyard in Broadford and that will be honoured.
Yeah, so the Fianna Fáil native seems to think there'll be good news, and I see there at the end of it, he says, we had agreed that 9th of October would be the agreed date. Now, David, do you know what happens on the 9th of October?
No.
It's
budget day.
Oh, yeah, okay. Well, nothing happens.
Then he says, if we get to the 10th of October, it'll be a different story.
Frustrated Mayor Cooney responded, we're sick and here in a couple of weeks at this stage. We have to move forward. Yeah. Would you contact me by the end of the week and with a date for this announcement? I am sick and hearing over a couple of weeks.
So does it, Pat, it does suggest, though, that... Well, it's happening, but that they just haven't announced it.
I know, yeah, but like he came to Bradford there.
That's over a year ago, I'd
over
say.
A year and a half.
Yeah.
Last spring, 12 months.
Yeah.
And he came and he said that he told them that there'd be good news in a couple of months.
Right.
Well, there's a couple of months and a couple of years now gone. when you're coming down saying that those things, you'll want to be backing it up because he also came down to the people with the pirate.
Yeah.
And he went over there to those people in the market, Handley's. And stood behind him, and he was and said he'd be hearing good news, but it took 2 years before anything ever happened about getting onto this pirate scheme.
Mm. No, and I think that's the way with our politicians. But listen, we'll move on because we're running a little bit short time. But on page 11 of the Echo, beside Joe's picture there, Knock Shanvo Wind Farm Webinar, Wednesday, October 11th at 7 p.m, and it's also on page 11 of the Champions.
So, well, I think Pat will probably be tuning into this one, and a lot of people from the Broadford and Six Mile Bridge area, because I'd never heard of Knock Shanvo. Of course, I'm a bit of a blow-in, so I suppose I wouldn't. But Knock Shanvo...
Pardon the pun.
Yeah. So Knock Shanvo is in the 12 o'clock hill area.
The hill is, yeah. One of the hills over there, yeah.
So... You've known that this might be coming for a while, but is this sort of the public consultation?
Well, there have been a few articles on it, and this is probably the part of it that we consulted with people.
Yeah.
So I think they have plans for about 12...
12 turbines.
Turbines along the hills there between.
So you have to register and receive the link, so you can't just join. You have to register, so they're sort of wanting to know who they'll have. So to register, you have to email Knock Shanvo, that's KNOCKSHANVO, @ futureenergyireland.ie before 12 p.m. on Wednesday, October 11th. In order to get that link. So I suppose that's the future now. It used to be, you know, turn up at a meeting in the hall.
Yeah.
Now it's webinar.
Yeah. I'd say you could blame COVID for that.
Yeah.
COVID, I'm sure there'll be a lot of consulting with consultants and consultation taking place. Anyway, but listen, we shall move on, and we're going to go to... another topic, David, that's close enough to us. Page 13... in the Champion, the East Clare note. Is a €1 million walking route being lost in the weeds?
Well, it's a good question, and I think we know the answer. This is the rather fantastic walking route that the council got money to put in between O'Gunnelow and Tuam Greinne.
Well, on the outskirts, as the man says, it would be great if they finished it. But anyway, it's literally between Killaloe. You have a path between Killaloe and about 300 yards outside of Tuam Greinne.
And okay, you don't see Tuam, but some people use it, and they're walking their dogs and they're running. And in the summer, it can be used. But
it's used year round, David.
Tis.
I know it's not always on your route, shall we say.
And maybe not at the time of the day that I'd be travelling it.
Yeah.
But I have actually walked from Tuam Greinne to Bale Kelly on it with the dog, and it's fully tarmacadam.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is, Luke, that the verges of it and the ditches get overgrown. That's nature for you. But nobody's maintaining it.
Yeah, and the Killaloe MD meeting took place last week, and you alluded there to a few other things that took place at it. And this is one that raised considerable ire with all the councillors in relation to it. And they're not happy, and they weren't happy with their own council staff in relation to it. And the question was put by, you know, Pat, now you'd be aware of, you know, you can't cut ditches.
Yeah, well,
but before the 1st September. But the issue that the councillors raised was the majority of this isn't actually a ditch.
Yeah, it's grass.
It's grass, and it's a verge.
Yeah, sure.
And that is not
banned from being cut.
No, because you can't get birds nesting
in
the
birch. The council can cut any ditch that's
for road safety purposes.
For road safety.
Yeah. But Luke's point is a good point, which is what the politicians, I think, were saying, that you can cut the verge anytime
you can.
Now, I know in certain parts along there, particularly between Killaloe and O'Gunnelow, that the locals themselves maintain it. Now, that's not right either, the locals have to maintain it. So there should be. I mean, if you spend so much money on this, you should. Just as we have roads that the council maintain, why don't they maintain the paths?
It wouldn't take an awful lot of money to bring the machine there. They only might
need to do it twice a year.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. Now, I think just from the local knowledge side of things, it wasn't cut before April. Right, which it should have been.
It should have
that
been.
Would
have,
because, like, in fact, the point that they make, it was well overgrown, and it was more overgrown after August. But I was on that road today, and there are bits on it where the high grass and stuff like that has been cut, but there's briars and are sort of taking over the path.
If they had done it in March before the closure of the time, and they could do it again in the 1st of September, and they had been keeping it trimmed.
Yeah, but sure, that'll make sense, Pat. So that's unlikely to happen.
There are weeds, ragwort, thistles. I have often been in Westport or Clonakilty where you don't see that. There seems to be no human resource issues down there where they can maintain areas, he said. It's very disappointing from a tourist point of view, and which is right, really.
Declan Flanagan, who is the executive engineer, confirmed the Killaloe MD had recently spent 2 weeks hedge cutting and clearing back the grass verge along the wall. So it's a bit late, I would say, Mr. Flanagan.
I would agree. Now, having spent some of the programme slating some of the goings-on of the council, I am going to finish on a positive note and give them credit. Because the main article there that Dan has on page 13, and there's a picture there by John Kelly, a view of the newly installed pontoon at Ballycogran, Killaloe. I'm afraid now we call it Two Mile Gate, but I suppose they take care of meeting. Basically, a new floating pontoon has been installed at the top of the pier, Two Mile Gate, which will allow people with physical disabilities to go kayaking and get easy and safe access to the water. And I think it's not just people with disabilities that will be able to get into it. I have seen this device in another area, and it's an easy way to get into the kayak without sort of fear of turning over. So it's very much to be recognised, and I will congratulate the council for the good work that they took place in relation to it.
They do a very good job down there in Two Mile. Did you say Two Mile Gate?
Two Mile Gate.
Like, it is very well maintained. So when they put their minds to it, they can do it all right. And but it's a very popular spot at all times of the year. And I know a lot of people swim down there, so this presumably will assist them too. And there's another article.
It is first in the kind in the country. There's no facility down there, and the equipment for getting people with disabilities into kayaks. But hopefully, it won't be
vandalised.
Yeah. Paddy Collins there is pictured at Ballina Riverside Pool just underneath that article. So there's a bit of a swimming theme going on there. A strong summer season at Ballina Riverside Pool. And just goes in for people in the area, goes into a little bit of detail on what is happening and how much it costs. And the level of activity is a very popular amenity for Killaloe and for others who want to go down.
Yep.
Of course, you just want the weather when it's an outdoor pool.
Well, that's true too. Right, listen, I think we're done. Hopefully the three of us have we're not done because sorry, Pat. Right, go on.
Just here, Luke, there was a book launched there recently, Clare G in the Championship 1887 to 2023. It's by Seamus O'Reilly. Seamus was owner and editor of the Clare County Express for 40 years.
Yep.
And he has put a huge amount of time and effort into a new book which chronicles Clare hurling and football county teams from 1887 up to 2023. And it's a huge booklet. And
if people might remember the old telephone directories, well, that's the size of it, and it's a lot heavier.
It's a big directory.
And We just tell people about it, it's out, and if they wanted to buy and anybody would be interested in the history of GA.
Where would they get it, Pat?
Well, you can get it, you can contact Seamus O'Reilly.
And I suppose it's probably in a few of the bookshops in Ennis as well, I presume. Well, if I, you think,
Seamus O'Reilly, Clonkilne, Belnakelly, Ennis, County Clare, or clarecountyexpress@gmail.com.
There you go, Clare County.
And the phone number is 085-745-0455. And we'll be having him on Saturday Connacht on the 14th of October. He'll be out talking.
Perfect.
About the
book. Great stuff. Right. Our own programme is sponsored by Ruth Griffin Photography. And I want to pass on our thanks to Ruth for saying. And Pat, we're going to finish up with...
Well, we are meeting Scotland next in the Rugby World Cup, Luke, and of course we'll play the flower of Scotland, and hopefully they won't be singing it next Saturday night.
Fair enough. All right, listen, that's it from us this week. Hopefully the band will all be back together next week. And so from us, for now, goodbye and take care.